Good evening, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started. Since 2013 in Bangladesh, several bloggers, as well as publishers and aid workers, have been intimidated, attacked, and brutally murdered. Most recently, several other writers and intellectuals have been openly threatened. In analyzing these horrific events, media headlines, both in the West and in South Asia, seem to all be asking one question, which is this the end of a secular Bangladesh? My name is Sanchita Saxena, and on behalf of the Subir and Malini Chowdhury Center for Bangladesh Studies, I would like to welcome all of you to tonight's very critical and timely panel discussion. We are extremely privileged to have with us three eminent scholars in their respective fields. Professors Ronak Jahan, Ali Riaz, both from political science, and Professor Dina Siddiqui from anthropology, who have all thought about these issues at great length. They will have the difficult task tonight of unpacking the complex questions of whether secularism in Bangladesh has truly eroded, if so, where has it eroded from, and what are the implications of this. The goal of the panel is not only to address these vital issues, but also to engage and encourage conversations between the disciplines. The panel will be moderated by the chair of the Institute for South Asia Studies, Professor Lawrence Cohen. Professor Cohen is a cultural anthropologist who teaches in the departments of anthropology and South and Southeast Asian studies here at Berkeley. He will engage with the panelists, have them also engage with one another, and then he will open it up to Q&A. Very briefly about the Chowdhury Center, as many of you know, this is the first center of its kind in the US to focus solely on Bangladesh's society, politics, economy, arts, and culture. The goal of the center is not only to begin to think about ways to combat challenges that the country faces, but also to highlight opportunities to learn from Bangladesh and envision how the country can serve as a model for innovation and development. We are able to do this in three ways. The first is to showcase innovative research and bring forth new ideas by hosting thought leaders and intellectuals from Bangladesh and those who study the country. The second goal is to train the next generation of scholars and expose students to Bangladesh and Bangladesh studies. In the last year, I'm very happy to say that we've been able to award 4 graduate fellowships, 1 undergraduate scholarship, and 3 paid internships to Bangladesh for last summer. And finally, another focus through the Chowdhury Center is to create opportunities for collaborative research between UC Berkeley and top universities in Bangladesh, designed not only to impart knowledge or build capacity, but to generate new research ideas, projects, and programs based on mutual understanding. I'd like to quickly mention, I think many of you know already, that we are hosting with the Bangladesh Development Initiative, BDI, a conference that will begin tomorrow and go on through the weekend. We have some information out there for the schedule. I hope to see all of you there. And without further ado, I turn it over to Professor Cohen.
So repetition in the academy is a virtue, so there'll be a bit of overlap, but appropriately, and appropriately from both the political scientists and anthropologists. We have here political scientists and anthropologists, and in part the dialogue is interdisciplinary. So in the British newspaper The Guardian this week, one reads the following words: demonstrations have continued over fatal attacks on secular writers and publishers in Bangladesh, suspected to have been carried out by hardline Islamists, with books burned and businesses closed in protest, unquote. A series of highly public events, killings of persons legible as secular bloggers, has generated intense focus on Bangladesh in a way different from earlier sites of publicity, from systemic poverty to impressive social education, credit, and health programs, to political violence to textile worker factory conditions. In perhaps distinctive ways within and without the country, we are presented with a political and ideological distinction between two camps, secularist and Islamist. Of late, this distinction has been amplified by concerns globally mediated that ISIS is operating in Bangladesh. What is the situation, both in Bangladesh in reference to these particular forms of violence and ranged against it of protest, and both in Bangladesh and in the dominant global media, of this presumptive binary? How might we struggle to understand both what is going on and how we come to talk of what is going on? What is to be done and by whom? Or if these are the wrong questions, how might we think otherwise? To think with and against these frames, we're fortunate today to have 3 very esteemed scholars, and I will introduce them alphabetically. I should note that when I say esteemed, I do mean esteemed, and to properly mention all their publications and titles and positions and degrees would take us through to midnight, so I will be very brief, even truncating titles after the colon. Professor Ronit Dehan is a political scientist and a distinguished fellow at the Center for Policy Dialogue in Dhaka. Her PhD is from Harvard, and she's taught at Dhaka, Harvard, and Columbia. She was the founder and the president of Women for Women. I will mention three of her many books to give you a sense of her breadth. First, Bangladesh Politics. Second, The Elusive Agenda, Mainstreaming Women in Development. And third, Pakistan, Failure in National Integration. I'm very glad to have her here. Professor Ali Riaz is a political scientist and university professor at Illinois State University in Normal, Illinois. His PhD is from Hawaii, and he has taught at Dhaka, Lincoln, and Claflin. He's worked for a journalist for the BBC. I will mention three of his many publications to give you a sense of his breadth. First, Islam and Identity Politics Among British Bangladeshis. Second, Inconvenient Truths About Bangladeshi Politics. And third, Islamic Militancy in Bangladesh. Professor Dina Siddiqui is an anthropologist and a professor at Brack University in Dhaka. Her PhD is from Michigan, and she has taught at Columbia and Hunter College. She has worked as network coordinator for the Center for Gender, Sexuality, and HIV/AIDS in Dhaka. I will mention three of her many articles to give you a sense of her breadth. First, Crime and Punishment, Laws of Seduction, Consent and Rape in Bangladesh. Second, The Social Life of Bangladeshi Fatwas. And third, Political Culture in Contemporary Bangladesh. Each of these scholars submitted some initial thoughts some weeks ago, and I will tell you that there are both impressive convergences as well as important distinctions between their thinking through what I am terming the question of the situation. I hope both will come out today. I'm going to ask each scholar to speak for 5 to 10 minutes, and I promise to stop you cold if you hit 15, and outline their thinking and a possible approach. I will then ask them if they have responses to each other, and if needed, ask a further question or two to generate discussion. But you want to hear them, not me, so if they enter into immediate discussion, that's even better. And then we turn it to you, the audience. I will ask audience members only one thing besides turning off your cell phones, I should do, that when we do come to the question and answer, that you keep your questions short and focused to enable more time for discussion. So I'm going to proceed in the same order of discussion and begin with asking Professor Ronit Dehan.
First of all, I would like to thank the Institute of South Asian Studies and also the Malini Center for inviting me to come here today and talk. At the outset, I have to say that I haven't really done any research on secularism or on religion. I think Ali Riaz has looked into some of these issues. So what I have to say is based on my long-standing interest and observation on Bangladesh politics. And of course, I also speak as a concerned citizen of Bangladesh. When Bangladesh was born in 1972 and I was a young adult, I never thought that I would live up to a time to see the kind of things that we see today in Bangladesh in terms of killings of bloggers or the bombing of a Shia procession. These were not something that we thought that we would see so soon or in my own lifetime. I think what I will do is make some general observation. First is how did we really conceptualize secularism in our constitution, or what did the founding fathers think what secularism meant? Secularism, the way we looked at it, it was not like a separation of church and state as was the French conception of secularism. Oh. The way we looked at, or founding fathers looked at secularism, was that there would be no discrimination on the basis of religion, and no particular religion would be privileged over another. So the way it was looked upon was that there would be equal treatment of all religions. And so what we saw in terms of practice, that in the early years, for instance, in any public function, you would have recitations from the scriptures of all four religions, from Islam, then from Bible, from the Gita, and the Buddhist Tripitaka. So that was sort of the standard practice. Also, for instance, there are all religious festival days were declared as public holidays. So one of my Columbia colleagues, for instance, Professor Al Stepan, who looked at secularism, and he was telling me that, in fact, on one of the indicators by which one looks at whether a particular country is more secular or not, was they were looking at whether all you have public holidays for all religions. So he was telling me, Rona, yes, Bangladesh is actually very high on that indicator because you have all four religions are declared as public vacations. Also, I think from the beginning, we had public funding of religious schools, for instance, so religious institutions. So in fact, the way secularism was conceived and practiced initially was more or less really the way secularism was conceived and practiced in India, for instance. And both Professor Al Stepan and Professor Bhargava, who has written a lot on secularism, has make a distinction between this different conceptualization of secularism in, say, France, in USA, and also, say, India or South Asia. I think one of the major concerns of our founding fathers, or the framers of the Constitution, when they put secularism as one of the guiding principles of state policy in 72, was that they didn't really want any instrumental use of religion for purposes of political mobilization. And this particular impetus came because of our experiences of living through the Pakistani colonial experiences, when religion was really used for political purposes by regimes who themselves really didn't have any particular ideological belief in Islam. So it was really used very instrumentally at that point. And this often led to communal violence. So that initially, I think the focus really was also on toleration of diversity. Jamaat was by Jamaat-e-Islami, which was the only ideological religious party that was banned in Bangladesh very soon after independence, and that was mainly because it was a religion-based organization, and we didn't want any organization based on religion. So very broadly, what changed since 72? One is that there had been major, we all know about this, major changes in the constitution that had taken place in 72. First of all, in 77, our first military ruler, Ziaur Rahman, he dropped secularism from the constitution. And then in 1988, the second military ruler, who is Irshad, he put Islam as a state religion. I think one should note that, again, both of these things were done by not people who believe in religion as an ideology, or they didn't have an ideological agenda, but they were, again, doing it in the same way as we had in the Pakistani period, that they were using it for very instrumental political reasons to get mobilized support behind their regimes. And one should also note that there was really no popular demand at any time that one should drop secularism from the constitution, or one should put Islam as a state religion. It was not done because of any movement in favor of that. And then in 2011, we have our latest amendment of the constitution, which is quite anomalous because we put back secularism in the constitution. And we put it back again because of a high Supreme Court's judgment, which said that that whole Zia period's all the changes were ultra-virus of the Constitution. But Islam was maintained, which the amendment that Ershad, the second military dictator, put, was maintained in the Constitution. So we are constitutionally now secular, but at the same time, we have Islam as a state religion. What I find interesting is that even that the secularism was put back in the Constitution in 2011, again, I think main justification was given is that it was the Supreme Court's decision. So there was not really a great deal of political mobilization to put this back. So what we now again have is the same kind of practice in public events, that we will have recitations of scriptures from all the religions. But it is interesting to note that the Awami League, which is a ruling party, the leaders, when they would start any public meetings, then they would feel obliged to say, start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, that we begin in the name of Allah, which was not the practice, say 20, 30 years ago. I was listening to Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib's very famous March 7th statement, that speech. For instance, here he starts the speech by saying Bhai Rama, which is like brothers, including, I think, I suppose, sisters, I always say. But that was the 70s, so then. But even though he didn't start with reference to Bismillah, but in the middle of the speech, he would use some expression that we would use in our ordinary expressions as Muslims. So when one phrase, he says, I will, inshallah, liberate Bangladesh. Desher manush ke mukto kore chhargo, inshallah. But that is the way we always spoke, you know, in an everyday practice. Anyway, in terms of popular practices, if I have to look at the changes very quickly, what I find as a major change since the 70s is that there is a much more outward public observance of religious practices in a much more public way. Before, it would be more, say, private. So that now you will find that in all the offices, hospitals you go, there would be people would be saying their prayers, which I think in the 60s or even early 70s, there would not be so much of a observance of religion in a very public way. The Ramadan, the iftar, parties, women wearing hijab, some of these kinds of public display is there. But then I think it is very problematic then from there to sort of conclude that it is becoming very Islamic, because that simultaneously what we have seen compared to, say, early 70s, a very public and huge observation, public celebration of Bengali identity. For instance, the Bengali New Year is celebrated in a very massive way with girls wearing white and red and flowers. Then the 21st February, which is the first day of spring, everybody again dressed up, and so the music. So that the so-called set of these two identities, Muslim versus Bengali, I think in terms of sort of very public kind of observation, both are going on simultaneously. What is common, I find, in terms of both celebrations is that there is a lot of consumerism involved, yes, in terms of, you know, buying all these dresses and, you know, or all the fees that go on with that. But at the same time, when you have so much of this public celebration and observances, there is some subtle pressure to conform, you know, in some way, which is much more, and some intolerance. Just to give an example, that when I went in 1982 to live in Malaysia, for 2 years I was working for the UN, I was very struck that in Bangladesh, up to then when I went there, in the teachers' common room where I was teaching, some people would be observing fast, some would not. But those who are not fasting, they could be having tea, and, you know, nobody, it was very tolerant about that. I And in Malaysia, when I went, and then rickshaw pullers or other day laborers, they needed to eat. So then restaurants would be open. There would be some kind of a curtain, but you can just go in and eat, and nobody would be, I mean, this sort of was all tolerated. When I went to Malaysia, I found that Muslims would not be served publicly. And I used to be very surprised because I hadn't seen that. But I find that now there is a little bit of a discomfort by people who don't observe to outwardly show that they are not observing. So there is sort of some change. One positive change, and I think that has happened since 70s, and I think that is all in support of, I think, secularism, is I think the women's presence in public sphere. In the early 70s, you would hardly see women on the streets in Bangladesh. But now, early in the morning, if you are in Dhaka, then you will see thousands of women walking the streets, going to garment industries or going to their work. And that is a major, major change. The popular acceptance of women in labor force. Popular, they may be wearing hijab or not, but they are in the public space. And when, for instance, 2 years ago, when Hefazat, for instance, Hefazat-e-Islam sort of came out with their very anti-woman agenda, there was a big push by many of the groups, even at a popular level. People thought in Bangladesh this is not on, because women's income is very, very important for family survival, even in poor households. So I think there is a great deal of popular acceptance of women working in the informal sector. Couple of quick points. Second is about democracy and secularism that I wanted to make. And that is that in all countries of South Asia, what we are all striving to do is to establish electoral democracy. And some, like India, is more successful than others, such as Bangladesh. But in the electoral democracy, what is happening is that all vote bank politics is going on. And so that in India, it is not that people are not, even that was successful democracy, people are not mobilized because of their economic policy differences. They're all mobilized around some vote blocks, that is Muslims or the caste blocks, or tribal blocks, so that all the mobilization that takes place is around these kinds of communal identities. Because Bangladesh is much more homogeneous than India, so we do not have so many of caste-based mobilization, but still, in terms of, if you have to think in terms of markers of various community differences, then religion does play one, is a marker, and then of course in Chittagong Hill Tracts, which is a very small area, you have the ethnic tribe, indigenous population. Again, very similar to India, as in India, the Muslims were supposed to be the Congress's vote bank, because Congress is supposedly a secular party. So in Bangladesh also, the Hindus are supposed to be the Awami League's vote bank. So then if one particular religion is supposed to be one particular party's vote bank, then what the other party does is to then also try to get more support from the other communities. So BNP targets more Muslim vote. Then what happens is, of course, is that it is not that the Awami League would not use religion, then they would also try to use to prove that they are also very Muslim, so that because the majority are Muslims. So that the instrumental use of religion has not stopped. What I think I find interesting is then the role of Jamaat-e-Islami, which is one of the ideology, the only ideological based party, which is a player also in our mainstream electoral politics. And I think they have played their electoral political game very well, mainly depending on their various strategies of alliance building that they have done, and they have gradually rehabilitated themselves. And until their student clique had been quite, I think, involved in some violent activities from the beginning. But the party as a whole, till 2013, they really did not push a very violent agenda. But now, of course, things have changed. So that, I think, the interesting question going forward is that how we would be dealing with Jamaat within a democratic space, because there are various kinds of actions and strategies that have been touted. In conclusion, let me make a few observations. And that is about our current situation. No doubt that there has been a lot of a sense of fear and the chilling and silencing effect. One of the problems is that there is very little trust in our police force or even that they would actually find the culprits or there would be justice. So in a situation like that, when there is a lot of credibility gap between the regime and, you know, what people, average people, then there is a scope for a lot of rumor mongering. So you really don't know what is happening there. And people are liable to believe in almost anything. But I think this is sort of a new ball game where it is not a numbers game when you are in electoral politics, but a very small group who believes in a particular ideology, then if they use terror, then they can create a lot of, I think, fear and have a chilling effect. And it is not very clear how the government is going to deal with all of this. They are talking about zero tolerance or that they would eliminate. But I think there is probably a you know, more realistic realization that, you know, you can never totally eliminate extremists. There would be in every country a small group of extremists. So their total victory that we thought in 72, I think, total victory on either side is not possible. I think that is there. I think the main challenge is how we would bring, negotiate in any democratic framework. Compromise and negotiation are very essential. But in the Bangladesh's overall political context, these things are very much missing because it is being played as winners versus losers. And I think in that kind of overall context, it's very difficult to think of any kind of compromise and negotiations. My own personal preference would be that if we could bring back in political discourse in Bangladesh, more debate on economic policies and the winners and losers as a result of our economic policies, and not talk so much about culture and identity, I think would be a better way of moving forward. And this, I think, is a problem not only in Bangladesh. Now that I'm here in this country, in the election cycle, and watching the Republican debate, and the contrast with the Democrats, I can also see that people, or some people, are more concerned about right of fetuses than right of living people who are dying of hunger and malnutrition. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. I thank the center for hosting. Thanks to Sancheta for giving this opportunity. I'm going to make 5 points, and I hope that will generate enough debate in the coming half an hour or so. They tend to be somehow been labeled as very provocative person. So let me provocate you on some of these things that I'm going to say. And I hope I will be able to have the opportunity to explain those things. These 5 points are false. Number one, any conversation about religion and politics, and particularly secularism in Bangladesh, tends to be very, very descriptive. Who did what at what point? Those things served us very well in past decades. But we have reached to a point that we need to look into this description, because often in this description, what we forget, what do we describe secularists? What is the lived experience of being secular in Bangladesh? Historically, socially, in the contemporary sense, what is religious mean when we are putting or pitting one against another? What does that mean? We haven't seen any, and you know, being my friend, I can actually blame the anthropologist of Bangladesh for not doing that kind of a work. That would help us. There are very few and far between. I mean, and of course, this descriptive nature of this work, I take blame for that too. My previous works have been like that. So I'm not exonerating myself on this occasion. But the central point is this: in the absence of the discussion on the lived experience, the diversity, the contradiction, as well as accommodation that we have seen, which has been there for long. I mean, if you go back to the history of Bangladesh, it has been there. So what changed? Is the lived experience changed? If so, what exactly is that one? Instead of labeling them, this is religious, this is secular, we need to go back and ask that question. That is my number one point, that I see as a major lacuna, as a major disadvantage of having the conversation in the current frame of the discourse. Number two that I'd like to bring is, for being the sake of the provocation, let me put it this way, that we tend to think secularism as an immutable concept. Once we got this right, and it is forever there. It is not. Secularism has emerged through various kinds of social and various kinds of contestation, political situation, society. It has a historical baggage that it carries, the term itself. And the things have changed. But often, my very close friend, secularist, seems to be getting the point that, no, once we have seen that this is an immutable concept, this is the statecraft that we have invented in 19th century, and that has to be there forever. We're not in 19th century. Hello, we are in 21st century. And when we are in 21st century, the idea that secularism is a historically shifting category seems to be a blasphemous statement. In the context of Bangladesh, and largely in South Asia, but given that we're not going to go to India, there's a whole lot of different problems, and we are friends there who are fighting that battle. But let me put it this way, that to insist that the meaning of secularism can be negotiated, renegotiated, and challenged has become a blasphemy in Bangladesh. So long we are stuck with that blasphemy, we are not going to go anywhere. That's my second point. My third point is, over the last 44 years, we have created a grand narrative with regard to history of Bangladesh, with regard to the role of the religion, with the role of political parties, with the role of politics, with the role of democracy. There's a grand narrative of this whole thing. And this, in this grand narrative, the national history has left very little space in which to recognize the internal tension and misunderstanding about secularism. In 1972 and 2011, in the same frame. In 1972, when the Constitution was made, you know, of course, I was too young to be a part of that, but not that young to forget completely, you know. Has there been any conversation? What sort of conversation did we have? Did we actually understood what secularism means? Can we actually separate secularism from the secularization? The way the concept of secularism has been introduced in most of the post-colonial society, and particularly the nation state, which came, you know, lock, stock, and barrel, you know, came up with this idea, and we accepted it. Should we have actually challenged that one? If not in 72, should we challenge that one now? And there's been enough work to do that one, whether, and sure, we can mention Talal Asad and others, but nevertheless, we do not have that conversation in the context of because it would actually question the grand narrative. And once you question the grand narrative, and let me tell you, This is my own experience. Once you get into that grand narrative and question that grand narrative, there are labels already ready to put on your back. You know, you would be on the crosshair, either of this or that. And so long we are not questioning this grand narrative. I'm not suggesting that this is right, this is wrong. I don't know. My point is that that grand narrative needs to be questioned. And that hasn't been done. And whenever we are talking about secularism, and thanks to Sancheta for introduction when she mentioned it in the question form, as opposed to how it is posted in the webpage. Had I been in, you know, if Sancheta has not made that introduction, I would have suggested, let's put a question mark there. Is it eroding? Because unless we put that question mark, we assume that there is a benchmark, and it is eroding from there. What is the benchmark? And that benchmark, if we consider that benchmark as the place from where we start, that is our point of departure or our destination, however you put it, put us in a very difficult spot. Put us in a very difficult spot because I don't think Bangladesh was ever a secular state. Because throughout the whole society, the secularization, the society's secularization has now taken place. This inverted position of creating a secular state, what happens if we create a secular state or call a secular state? And we have seen it in other, you know, post-colonial states. The state is imposed, and then the question of religion and the role of religion is then pushed into the society, where it stays, and at time it comes back and try to recapture the state. And that is what is what I see as happening in case of Bangladesh. My fourth point is the current situation. I completely disagree with Guardian. You know, the reason I disagree with Guardian, because I see Guardian as a representative of a certain discourse. And same thing with New York Times. And I can refer a number of newspapers right from Bangladesh, but given that you are more familiar with New York Times and Guardian, let me put it this way, this discourse, this frame of putting that this is a battle between Islamism and secularism is, in my judgment, completely misunderstood understanding about Bangladesh history. By putting at a very superficial level, and again, I am not justifying, I have no intention of justifying anybody, any heinous act of killing. Act of killing is a criminal act, should be dealt with, and nobody should get away with that. The culture of impunity needs to go. The culture of fear that has permeated Bangladeshi society over the last years, possibly as a continuation of the decades, needs to be challenged. Civil society needs to stand up. I have all these things. But to put it in this frame actually weakens the very fabric of this society. It is not about Islamism. It is not about secularism, because we haven't talked about secularism, let alone talking about the Islamism. Who represents Islamism? That brings me to the fifth point. You know, after that I will stop. I know I have already made you guys cringing for asking questions. You know, the fifth point is, who represents political Islam in Bangladesh? Is it Jamaat-e-Islam? Is it Hefazat-e-Islam? Is it these militant groups that exist who now intends to all intents and purposes, they would like to be IS or AQIS. Does not necessarily mean they have become. What is happening is candidates are proving their worth. It is a selection process, perhaps. They are just becoming candidate and showing their strength that I am better than others. But that does not mean that they, if opportunity occurs, they will get there. But the reason I'm saying who represent Islamism, because the political Islam has various kinds of faces. And these various kinds of faces, if we try to have a one cookie-cutter solution, will create more problems. If anybody would like to have an illustration, a demonstration of what happens, let us go back to 2001 and let us remember this nightmare of living through the Bush administration of 8 years. everyone is either us versus them, we end up where? Look at the US policies. This is where we ended up. I lose more friends, at least students in my classroom. They walked out and never came back from war. Us versus them frame, at the end of the day, whether it is written in Dhaka or shaped in Washington or Brussels, whether it is spoken by Mr. Blair or Bush or someone else, makes no difference. It's not going to bring any solution. And that is where we are heading, unfortunately. Often I see that phrase in Guardian, in New York Times, and in Dhaka. Stop there,
then
I hope.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody, for helping to organize this very interesting thing. I may not be as coherent as my fellow panelists. I'm just going to throw out a few ideas. In support of anthropologists who have been studying secularism in Bangladesh and elsewhere, and I'll be using anthropological frames, hopefully. Yes, I'll try to be louder. What I thought I would do as somebody, again, who doesn't study secularism per se, is step back and look at the conceptual frames that drive dominant understandings of what's happening in Bangladesh today. And I think, it follows very nicely from what Professor Ali Riaz was saying. And I want to look at the consequences of the binary framings that the New York Times and the Guardian, but also lots of people within Bangladesh, are so invested in. I think this investment in the fight between Islam and a secular nationalism is a very significant part of national identity inside Bangladesh and part of the problem. So on the one hand, you have the secularist fear of the dangers of Islam, right? Islam will take over and destroy what we have, made with, all of that, the blood that's been spilled. So you have that, and then you have another, perhaps minor discourse of Islam is in danger. And Islam is in danger from the West, from imperialism, from various other things. So that they're both playing out. But the driving narrative, the main narrative, is that of Islam in danger. And there's a moral panic that's generated by this binary framing of fundamentalism versus secularism. And I think what it does, and as you pointed out, there is this desire to bring ISIS, for instance, into the picture. And what it does is it depoliticizes certain very important issues and obscures a certain kind of politics. It's very telling that the father of the publisher who was killed last week, one of the things he said two things. He said the Awami League is playing with the politics of secularism and the BNP is playing with the politics of religion. But they're both playing, right? There's no investment in something more real. And he said, in the circumstances, I will not seek justice. I will not go to the courts. It's very important to think about why he said that, okay? And why he is so adamant about that. And it has to do with the complicity of the current so-called secular Bangladeshi state in much of what's happening. And there is a way in which when we're so obsessed with Islam, whether it's global or local, we forget to look at the kinds of power plays involved in the state. It's important, again, I think, to remember there's tremendous fear in Bangladesh, and there's a tremendous sense of hopelessness, as I know those of you who've come know, especially with this latest spate of killing of bloggers and publishers. But the fear has been there for a long time and predates these killings, and it has to do with the power of the state, as much as of these so-called Islamists, the power of the state to pick up people, to silence people, to disappear people. Let's not forget RAB. Let's not forget the incredible lack of accountability, what you're calling the culture of impunity. And I think one of my fears is that, first of all, we have to look at the larger transnational aspect in which Bangladeshi politics unfolds, and we tend not to look at that, especially the politics of empire. But today in the world, we live in a very paradoxical sort of moment, right? Where there's fear, but there's this there's an extraordinary suppression of dissent by democratic liberal states using liberal laws for illiberal ends. And Bangladesh is no different in this sense from the US or France or India at this point. And it's not what it's being justified in Bangladesh, it's not unrelated to the global sort of securitization discourses and policies that we see. But we have to be vigilant, I think, to not simply fall back on this Islam as danger narrative, because not only because we sort of, you know, can ignore Euro-American culpability, but I think because it leads to a kind of ignoring the power of the state, the increasing hardening of certain kinds of state power to silence dissent. And the biggest problem, I think, in Bangladesh right now is the squeezing of spaces of dissent. And again, I think it's a problem in South Asia, not just in Bangladesh. Recently, the journalist David Bergman was talking, you know, on his blog about Sisi's Egypt and how suddenly, you know, everybody seems to be very happy with the kind of horrible authoritarian power in of this new secular government, but it is a secular government, and the donors and development partners are perfectly happy to support it as long as the Muslim Brotherhood is out of power. And I think David brings up something very interesting about Bangladesh, is that I think our development partners, such as they are perfectly happy too in many ways, as long as, because I think having this, I'm not saying it's a bogey, obviously there are these killings happening, but as long as you can keep this one narrative be dominant, it serves so many different interests that we have to think about. So that's one point I want to make. The second point is, since these killings, I want to talk about this discourse of tolerance and a politics of lamentation, I think, that we see in Bangladesh. Now, there's a lot, particularly after the killing of the attack on the Shia procession, there is a lot of lamentation, and I think it's perfectly justified in many ways about how we are becoming less and less tolerant. It's a very frightening situation in Bangladesh right now, but I think calls for us to become more tolerant of difference is again calls that are depoliticizing in some ways, because it tends to be about individuals. You know, the understanding is that there are individuals who are succumbing to cultural prejudice or who are not able to shed their culturally backward ideas about the other. Instead, and in this, you know, I think anthropologists of secularism in other places have been very interesting. Mayanti Fernanda, for instance, talking about a very different context of Muslims in France, talks about remarks that in contemporary neoliberal conceptions of society, we have a transference of responsibility for social relations away from political institutions and onto private individuals. And private individuals appear to be so, it's as though it's on the individual that what is happening, if there is violence, say, against Shia, somehow it is the problem of the individual rather than larger structural or institutional politics and formations. We've got to, I think, realize, for instance, that Bangladeshi political institutions have been deeply implicating in producing difference and inequality, socially, legally, and culturally, and which has to do with the refusal of Dipon's father for justice. But also, for instance, we have discrimination inscribed in the constitution, and this is, I want to go to my third point now, about perhaps we shouldn't think of secularism as simply I think there's a danger in thinking of being nostalgic about a moment where there was secularism, and now it's eroded and we have something else. But the secularism that we're thinking about is certainly very fractured and contradictory. But secularism is not the same as justice and democracy. So, for instance, you have the much talked about 15th Amendment to the Constitution that was brought up. Yes, it reinstated secularism as a value, but it also, at the same time, it reinforced a certain kind of Bengali ethno-nationalism, right? So you have in there, already there's an exclusionary politics in there, so you have Bengali speakers who are the majoritarian privileged community, but non-Bengalis, particularly, it's very clear that people who don't speak Bengali, especially people who are now called people of the small groups, indigenous groups, right? Their indigenous groups don't exist. But this is in a secular constitution. I think the point I'm trying to make is that we're at a moment, perhaps we need to think about what kinds of things. Secularism as a project is a regulatory project. We know secularism is, and religion are mutually constitutive. We know all of that. But perhaps we have to think beyond secularism as the problem and think in a larger scheme about what we mean. Perhaps we can move from talking about the politics of secularism to a politics of justice, which is a very different thing. Because secularism, I think, is inadequate as a framework to think about this. For instance, if you're thinking about Hindus right now in Bangladesh, if you were just to look at a certain kind of secularism in which, formal secularism, things seem to be very nice. We just had Durga Puja. We had a fantastic public celebration of Durga Puja all over the country, and it seemed, protected by the state. Great. A wonderful public performance of secularism in Bangladesh. But what this does is it also obscures the kind of structural everyday violence against Hindus who also, because there's a lot of primitive accumulation through land grabbing going on. And of course, it's, Hindus and other minorities were the most vulnerable to that. But we don't ever talk about that, right? Because because I think certain things are privileged, certain ways of seeing are privileged when we talk about secularism as a fixed thing. Finally, and I will end, is that I think, going back to the grand narrative, one of the biggest problems in Bangladesh is that the telling of the nationalist story has become such a fraught issue, but it's also produced its own secular blasphemies. So you and I were both in this court case involving about what we could talk about what how many people were killed in 1971 and all of that. But clearly, as long as we can't, one of the effects of this, of course, is that, there is an incredible silencing in the name of patriotism. A second thing is that I think there are different kinds of bodies that are generated. So the bodies that are disappeared by RAB and the bodies that are disappeared by the state, so those kinds of bodies become disposable and criminalized. The bodies that are burned in BNP. But then you have, and I mean no disrespect, but then there are sacred bodies, the bodies of the bloggers who are killed, the bodies of the publishers who are killed. There's a kind of hierarchy of suffering that we've produced too. Mm-hmm. As we think about this sort of story of secularism and recouping secularism and taking it, protecting it from the Islamists. So I'll just leave it there. Thanks.
So what I'm going to do is, what I plan to do is to have a discussion between panelists. What I'm going to do because of time is to do something slightly different, which is I'm going to just say a few words, and then I'm going to turn it to questions, but I'm going to also suggest that the questions become a way for you to engage each other and to take this further. So let me start and work backwards. So for Dr. Siddiqui, we have a sense of a narrative which becomes complicit with a kind of abandonment of the state. All that becomes the occluded with the focus on a given narrative, the figures of lamentation and nostalgia she centers on. For Dr. Liaz, opening with a extraordinarily anthropological call for lived experience, we again have a sense of troubling the binary and its immutability. Again, its relationship to broader geopolitical interests and its failure to engage with the problem of the contemporary, with what forms of language and concept might be at stake now. One might think that with the focus on lived experience and on the critique of the question of the secular, this was then a strong contradistinction to Dr. Jahan, but I want to argue something differently. I want to start with the moment that you began with, which is the figure you said, I never thought I would live to see this type of violence. And one could be that both, certainly for me hearing it, a painful question of lamentation, but not only on the one hand a politics lamentation, but also an appeal or a voicing of lived experience. And it's mm-hmm. and I want to think about both the limits, the relationship between affect and its politics, about the relationship between a sense of loss and the way that sense of loss becomes central to how a state operates, produces its exclusions, fails to attend to history. And I want to take one other piece from Dr. Jahan, which is giving us a sense that in the documents, the speeches of the state, some classic speeches in the formation of the state and in formal documentation, we have at least two voices. We have on one hand a series of formal procedures which produce a distribution of religions or stop, but we also have the way in which, as you put it, the language we use every day comes through those documents. So I'm struck by how it is that we read both people against or abandoned by the state, but also how do we read the state itself through this question of lived experience? What is the way, so your questions ask me to think about it in my hearing, about the ways in which the language of the state itself opened us in complex ways to the demands that all speakers made. So I'm gonna, with that note, turn it to the audience, and again, please try to keep your questions short, and I've already seen three or four hands, so I'll try to take them in order, and I'll probably stand here so I can see you all. I'm gonna start, because I saw it first, Professor, I'll start, I'm third, so please.
Thank you, Phyllis. I have a question that maybe picks up on where Dina ended, and this is this question of the ways in which secularism and Islam are paired to one another, where it seems that Islam is fundamentalist, and secularism is then what, moderate? It's something else, it's something restrained. But I think Dina is right to point out they're actually shared discourses of a kind of tyranny when you have this two-party system, right, where one party is trafficking in either discourse at a time, and both are in the sort of service of a kind of absolute power. So I want to ask a question about what the third term might be. What if we are not caught in the binary of secularism and Islam, what is it? And if the question is one of justice, where do you seek justice in the face of a strong state, right? If you're not looking to the state for justice, where does that third term justice emerge? Are you talking about popular movements, which of course we saw briefly 2 years ago? Are you talking about electoral reform? I mean, what are the forms that alternative imaginings actually take up?
So I'm going to suggest we take all three questions at once and then turn it to the panelists.
This is a lot of high-sounding words that I don't understand. I'm a physicist. Okay, so pardon if my questions are kind of naive. Growing up through the independence movement of Bangladesh, what I hear and what I have observed, there are two Bangladeshes. They are the intellectuals sitting in Dhaka, pontificating on secularism versus Islam and all this other stuff. Now, when I go to the countryside, they could care less. They could care less. They are more worried about the everyday living. And let me tell you why. In 1971, I supported the independence movement of Bangladesh. I was a young lecturer, university lecturer. I was a secularist. I still am, in a sense. My father was a Muslim immigrant from India. He supported Muslim League during 1947, and he voted for Mujibur Rahman in 1971. He did not become a secularist. So there was a whole structure created by the state and the Awami League saying that all of a sudden these people have become secularists. They have not. It was a political decision to vote for Mujibur Rahman. At the same token, I know there is a lot of pain going on among the intellectuals for the bloggers' killings. Trust me, guys in Himayatpur are not worried about the bloggers. So there are two Bangladeshes here that you need to realize that yes, the killing of the bloggers caused a lot of pain. I knew Abhijit personally, caused a lot of pain. But I didn't see the pain when I talked to people in obscure places in the country. What do you think of that?
And last question.
In the U.S., you made some reference to well, there is plenty of tension, Republicans and Democrats, and one way of viewing that tension is some sort of secular versus religious viewpoint, where maybe the Republican right, you think of them as the religious people who feel under threat, and the secularists. But I think another way of thinking about that same divide, it to me seems to make more sense, is that the you have the Republicans made up of what you could call the angry white men who've lost their union jobs and they'll never have the same kind of job again, and they see threats from immigrants, and it's all about economics. And I wonder whether, I don't know if I'm right or not, but that's how I see it, but I wonder if there's any kind of parallel in Bangladesh where, you know, this secular religious divide may be also related to an economic divide. Maybe that's a little like what you were saying. And I, by the way, I'm a chemist, so I don't know.
Thank you.
Okay, let me try to address some of these. Going back to the question, or the last one, about the two Bangladesh that have emerged, and I tend to agree with you that the two Bangladesh has emerged over time. And how did it happen? How did we arrive here? By creating more binaries, by creating more division. Will that help us to mitigate? Will there be a bridge there? If we keep on identifying in a different manner, and otherness is created not only in terms of just how they look, and I completely agree with the Venus point that this majoritarian argument is being sold, resold, repackaged, packaged in various ways. On the one hand, the same person who is supportive of the majoritarian argument as a Bengali would not exactly accept the majoritarian argument about them being Muslim.
That's right.
How come? Didn't you tell 30 minutes ago that you support the majoritarianism? You said that these people should not be indigenous and something that we cannot find an English for that? But yet, when it comes to Muslim identity, that becomes, no, that is not I'm going to accept. So that is what happens when we keep on reproducing the idea of us versus them. And that is where I'm trying to reach out to. And in the context of the current context, how we arrived here, we have reproduced that through that grand narrative, each and every time we have been told. And now it has become to reach to the level that even questioning anything would land you in a place that it is very difficult to crawl back up. That is not how you are going to resolve this issue. And that brings me to the point of, you know, this binary question. What is the third one? You know, let me quickly, because I should find out. Let me put it this way. I think the issue of secularism is not an issue of religion versus non-religion. Mm-hmm. It is a matter of diversity. How do you address the diversity? How the state actually addresses the issue of diversity? And diversity could be religious, diversity could be ethnic, diversity could be of my thought, you know? And when there is growing, over the last years, what I have seen, the shrinking space, I cannot speak. And if I cannot speak, I cannot criticize, which is perceived by someone as a criticism of religion, and then I became a target. Or if my criticism is perceived by someone questioning this narrative, then I become someone who is not exactly in the Mukti Juddha Chetana, meaning the spirit of liberation, or someone who say I am anti-state. You pick up your term. That's why I think that the conversation, and I completely agree with you, you know, on this point, that it is a question of justice, it is a question of diversity, addressing the diversity, and that is how it should be. We cannot, instead of secularizing the religion, we have secularized the secular. You know, some bodies are more sacred than others. So long we accept that one, that a death is different from the other death. And extrajudicial killing that took place in last night is different from the one which took place in the daytime, we are not going to get justice. It is very difficult to say that, and I am sure when it is put in on waves, you are going to put it on internet, and I'm going to get some questions for that. But so be it, what can I do? That is where we stand.
Couple of points. I think, you know, as academics, we all know that binary categories don't really represent reality. We have multiple identities. At some point, we would be more Bengali, but simultaneously, we are also Muslims. And then, of course, I'm a woman. So we all have multiple, identities. But when we are in electoral politics, there, of course, you are in a very, you know, in a contestation. And at that time, there is a political imperative to create these kinds of differences, particularly if you don't want to talk about rich and poor or economic differences, but you then are going to get, you know, are asking for a vote. So that this, it is much in politics, much easier to talk in binary terms, in us versus them, me versus the other person. And particularly, say, in Bangladesh, which generally was quite a homogeneous place, if you then are into electoral contestation, you do have to create differences so that then there would be the homily, which would stand for some things, and then the BNP, they would have to stand for something. So I think that, as academics, it is fine for us to reject binary way of looking at things. But in real world, in politics, I think these binary categories are used. Grand narratives are very, very important for political mobilizational purposes. For if you are trying to get a lot of people behind you, you cannot be so analytical with so much diverse smaller points, and then you are going to lose your crowd. And so that is grand narratives, binary categories, they are all, these are, you know, no matter what we say in classrooms, we can trash them. But you cannot get out of that situation in the real world when you are in the political sphere, particularly also when you are in a electoral contestation. So we have to, I think, live with this. But I think what I think the differences and my saying the to one point where I actually disagree with Ali Riaz is that when he said that in 72 there was no discussion about secularism. But all through our 50s and 60s, as our nationalist movement was gaining popular support, I think there was, a lot of discussion at that point that we didn't want to be like Pakistan, that we didn't want, we are Muslims, you know, everybody, all the Awamilik leaders and national leaders in their personal daily living, they were Muslims, but that you did not want to then use religion for inciting communal violence or creating again us versus the majority minority, that category. So I think that it was not that there was never any discussion, and that suddenly that in our constitution we put in secularism in an unthinking way. There was by 1970, after 20 years of all that mobilization, there was some understanding about this consensus amongst the elite about these four guiding principles of democracy, nationalism, secularism, and socialism. So I just don't think that that secularism, as I said, in that way, that it would mean that there would be no particular religion would be privileged, that there would be tolerance towards diversity, that religion would not be used to incite communal violence. I think there was a lot of discussion in the 60s and 50s about those issues, and so it didn't suddenly sort of spring from heaven at that point in 72. When I said that why I thought that I would not live to see this day, again, I think it really, the many things over the years that have been happening more and more within Islam, having all these various sects, all the violence, that you would have violence in a mosque killing the Shias, and that the use of violence, that we have seen enough violence, and I thought that at least that we would not use violence as an expression, so that is to silence dissent. But that doesn't mean that I would not agree with whatever was said, that there is also a lot of state-level violence, I think one of the problems is now the shrinking of the democratic space, and it is just not that, and when the democratic space gets shrunk, then of course violence is sort of one way of expressing yourself, I think, so that is the problem.
Let's see, let me try and put a couple of the questions together about the two Bangladeshes and the kinds of possibilities for a third. And I think I would say there are many Bangladeshes. I'm not sure there are two Bangladeshes, and I think that's very much part of nationalisms. You know, people have very different stakes in being a citizen or being, you know, part of a nation. So, and the kind of dominant strand of nationalism one sees in the city, I suppose you could say, is very much a reflection of our bourgeois interests. So that's there. That's where, you know. So there are many different kinds of interests, and I think perhaps that also ties in with the question about secularism, the secular religious divide, the kind of muktijodher chetona, the spirit of 1971 that intellectuals talk about in Bangladesh that we, in the secular intelligentsia, talk about, doesn't necessarily encapsulate the concerns of everybody, you know, your average garment worker who is very much in the city and not in the countryside might have a different way of expressing their stakes in the nation, right? So I think there are multiple Bangladeshes and, you know, nationalism, the kinds of national discourse that we generate and we hold sacred often and invariably, and by virtue of the way nationalism is constructed, exclude most but the most powerful sort of, you know, things in there. I've glommed onto justice just because one wants to get away from this binary, right? But do I really know what that means? Thank you for asking that ridiculously difficult question, right? As though I would have an answer. But I think what I see in Bangladesh, again, looking at, for instance, I think the language of justice is very important, and it's very important for us to disentangle it from the language of human rights. And I work with a lot of human rights organizations in Bangladesh, so I say this in a, you know, because I think human rights language can be very useful sometimes, but it's also very compatible with neoliberal forms of economic distribution, right? So I'm going to leave that aside. I think where certain kinds of social movements in Bangladesh right now, for instance, there's been this tremendous mobilization around garment workers that people on the ground are doing. So this woman, Taslima Akhtar, there's a group called Activist Anthropologists, there's this woman, Taslima Akhtar. You know, they're really mobilizing garment workers on the ground to do long-term work. So it's long-term social movements, not NGOized kind of, let's all do human rights now. That is going on in Bangladesh, and it's not you know, it's not the big NGOs either, I think. I think where I could see change happening, where a different vocabulary of justice could emerge from, is from these now invisible to both donor politics and to the state, those kinds of things that are happening at the grassroots level do give me a lot of hope. But I think that's where I would leave it.
So I'm going to take two last questions, then there's going to be 20, and I'm taking two. And then we'll continue after our speakers speak with more questions outside with food and... with just to call you. Okay, then we have more time. Okay, I can... Oh, I have three questions. Okay, sorry. I'm going to start with Tinku, then go to the right, and then...
You know, I must say that I'm quite disappointed at the what I've heard today with the panel discussing. It's quite fine to phrase everything under as one questioner asked about fancy language and all that. But I hope that phrasing it also actually connects to reality. Reality in Bangladesh is that secular space is decreasing. Whether we frame it and say that, well, you know, it's about justice, true. Whether we say it's about diversity, true. Majoritarianism, true. But let's just name it. Secularism is decreasing in Bangladesh. People, I mean, of course, all kinds of minorities are under attack because democratic space is decreasing. Space is, you know, is becoming constrained. But Islam is a huge problem in Bangladesh. I mean, we can be in the West and be scared about talking, denouncing Islamism in certain way because of the Islamophobia that is prevalent here. But we are talking in the context of Bangladesh. And in Bangladesh, Islamism is on the rise. And it is very scary. Of course, the panelists here, you know, are not from a religious minority. So it is very difficult for them to necessarily feel, even though they may have, you know, different affiliations or may not have the earlier, you know, affinity to the majority religion that is in Bangladesh right now. But nonetheless, you know, Hindus and other minorities, religious minorities, are very scared in Bangladesh. I mean, you talk to them, you just know that they have to be scared even walking down the street. Because it's a matter of somebody, you know, denouncing them in something, and then there could be more violence against them. And even though we say that all deaths, all killings are terrible, I mean, to any victim of any killing is, you know, it's hard to say, oh, your killing is not as bad as the other person. But when there's killing with a message, when voices who are being killed because they are talking about rationality or in some way about Islamic extremism, that killing is very significant, and that is why they're being killed, because it is significant. And we cannot just escape all these things and hide under, you know, just general language about, oh, you know, it's about democratic space and everything else, but and not just name the elephant in the room, that it is Islamism that is increasing in Bangladesh, and we should be denouncing it. Just a week ago, there was this a film I watched, The Final Solution, where this filmmaker and also prominent Indian activists, artists, and everybody else is coming out and denouncing Hindutva. They're not saying, oh, it's about democracy and all this. They're just going out and denouncing Hindutva. Why can't intellectuals and activism from Bangladesh denounce Islamism in Bangladesh? That's all.
Yeah, I'm not as old as Basudaman Bhai. I'm a year older than him, too. But I've been 36 years removed from Bangladesh because I've been living in this country. I've been to my village twice in the last 3 years to bury my granduncle and my father. And I noticed something very interesting. You don't see or hear about any violence or aggression against indigenous Hindus or indigenous minorities. So Mrs. Jahan's point of economics playing a role is really real. You know, like Manuel Castell said, you know, the new colonizers are the indigenous powerful, they become the new colonizers, it dribbles down to the village level. And I've seen that in fact, for instance, the richest Hindu family that lived in our village, they're basically gone, they're gone. Their house, because it'd be too blatant, their house was not usurped by the powerful in the village. It was made into, and I'm glad about that, it's made into a maternity ward, and deals with, you know, poor villagers that need the maternal, health issues are resolved there. But when I asked about what happened to the lands, you know, the people in the lower hierarchy in the village would not tell you, but they would tell you that it's being usurped by, you know, the rich and the powerful in the village. So that's one point. Number two, I'll try to make it short. Right after liberation, I was a school student. There was a debate, and in Bengali, the saying was, dharma nirupekkhata dharma hinota noy. What it means is, people started to question, what is secularism? If you have no, you know, if secularism is lack of religion, or the accommodation of religion. And the point that Tinku made, I remember Bangladesh 36 years ago, that I left as an undergrad, and I see the Bangladesh today. It is totally different, okay? You go down to the villages, people were religious then, but there was a lot of tolerance. You know, there are all the different sects. You know, people lived, they got along. They don't get along today. And part of it is also economics. You have all these indigenous workers working in the Middle East, bringing with them, back with them, a brand of Islam that they're trying to essentially force upon the rest, with the argument that you are lesser of a Muslim if you don't accept this. And I can see that. So that's the three points I wanted to make.
I'll pass in the interest of gender equality. I think
you have a gender. But okay.
So. Yeah, yourself, yeah.
Hi, first of all, thanks to the center for arranging such a timely discussion. So I've been living here for almost 26 years and very much involved with the Bangladeshi community in different types of, especially this specific topic on blogger killing. And we arranged a big rally, demonstration actually, when Abhijit was killed. A lot of friends of Abhijit came. We had almost 150 people. So my interest is to know expats living in U.S. or globally, what should we do? Because when, what we have been seeing is that there is a two group. One is very much, very liberal and very accommodating to differences, diversity, whatever that diversity is, from, homosexuality to religion to no religion. But then there is this very a group that's growing and growing and very fast growing, who are very not accommodating. So my question to the panel is, what as expats, what should we be doing? What is the expectation, or how can we help in kind of address this issue about secularism?
Tough question, Tammy. Oh, one more question first then. Okay.
I'm not a Bangladesh expert in any way, but I was very intrigued, especially with Jahan's reference to secularism being understood not in the way that it's understood in the West, or in France at least, with the idea of the laissez, the separation, strict separation of church and state. It seems to be pretty endemic in much of Asia, South and Southeast Asia, but that's how it's been understood. Because the debates that you referred to in the 1950s and 60s were the debates that happened in the Indian Constitutional Assembly as well. What are we going to mean by secularism? Of course, it was not included in the Constitution at that point, not even in the preamble. It was brought in much later. Actually, it was brought in by Indira Gandhi. But it did defer to, nonetheless, the ideas that people like Gandhi, Munshi, various other people, including Ambedkar to some extent, were talking about, which was the dharma samuchaya, the acceptance and tolerance of all religions rather than the strict separation. In fact, as Charles Taylor and people have pointed out, Shama Mahmood more recently, that the secularism, that the way the French had conceived of, has actually never happened anywhere in the West, much less in the US. I mean, we know that. The vote banks here are based along religious party lines as well, if you like. And never in England. You still have the monarchy there tied to the Church of England and so on. So, you know, some of this myth of secularism that the West has propagated as part of the making of this liberal empire is not germane to democracy. Democracy can be formed. In other words, just recently in this island of Fiji, which was ravaged by 2-3 coups and so on, has become a wonderful example of a democratic society where all the religions are now have almost equal share in the running of things, and all the different diverse groups as well, the racial groups, including the Indians. It's a wonderful experiment just sort of come about. So, you know, secularism is not a terrible sin as some people tend to sort of argue. I think there is something to be salvaged from that in that other nuance that I think you highlighted very rightly, which is what's probably being eroded, right? I mean, that's probably the idea. Is there some way of getting back to that?
Okay, let me take quickly. I'm not suggesting alternative to secularism. I'm suggesting alternative secularisms, okay, if I may phrase it in this way. I mean, that is the closest I could come immediately to talk about. And going back to what you have referred to is this conversation that only in a democratic society you can have that conversation. If the democratic space is completely gone or shrinks, that would limit the voices in all spheres. Democracy, when it is shrinking, doesn't shrink. Okay, this part is going to shrink and that part would remain open. No, it doesn't. It doesn't happen like that. And that is where, to a certain extent, I disagree with Dina. Of course, there are what we are witnessing in the United States or France is some relevance to our understanding of Bangladesh. But at the same time, we need to understand the historical context within which what we are witnessing now in terms of the democracy that we see. I'm not a very huge fan of electoralism. You know, there is a fallacy of that. But nevertheless, if the society does not allow to talk, it would not allow to talk about the power, it would not allow to talk about religion, it would not allow to talk about anything else. And that is why, whenever someone asks me, so what do you think? I think our leaders, those who the founders of Bangladesh were great when they talked about, human dignity, justice, and equality. And those were part of the Declaration of Independence. Why those were part of the Declaration of Independence in 1971 in April? Because they knew that those are the things, those are the fundamentals. And to build Bangladesh based on those fundamentals is the one that needs to be done. There's no other way, because this is what we promised the nation, our founders, and as we grew up, we need to remain committed to, and that commitment needs to be reaffirmed every time. It's not that it's given once we say it, and how do you do it? Let's talk. Let's have the platform to talk about it, and that's my point. And going back to my last point about what the experts can do, underscoring this, not only within our community here, but also raising voice, that what exactly is happening. Again, I'm referring to Dina and David mentioned that Sisi government is fine so long they are somehow managing the Islamists, putting them at bay. That's it. We need to raise voice. This debate, this struggle, if you want to call it a struggle, is not exclusively about Bangladesh when you are standing here. Because that is, you cannot say, okay, I support Sisi government doing it in Egypt, however, I do not want this to be done in Bangladesh. You cannot. I don't think you cannot. You can. And that's why if you take a principled stand on that, or you say, okay, I will be politically expedient, as Bangladeshi political parties have been. I would use Islam 3% this year, and the next election term I would use Islam 17% because that has changed. And that has been the case with the Awami League and the Bangladesh Nationalist Party. That has been the case since 1991, when the electoral democracy started. Whenever whoever found expedient to use the religion, instrumentalizing, if I may borrow the word from Professor Ronak Jahan, they have done it. And in the process, the erosion is, the state has become an instrument of those, you know, things. And that's why the confidence, there's very little confidence on the state. But to restore that, restore the space from within which we can speak and take a very principled stand, taking a long-term view that Bangladesh is not going to go anywhere. Got to make sure it is not going to go anywhere. And so, just not this election cycle, not just 2015, not 2019 or 2041, we need to look far beyond that.
I want to make one set of observation, and that is that the way we are, as I mentioned before, the way we understood secularism at that point is in fact that all religions would have equal place and you would be tolerant of diversity. But then, you know, at least my lived-in experiences from Bangladesh is that you get a popular support behind an idea when it is not a state-sponsored project. The idea of both democracy and secularism, particularly, that caught on to people because it was against the state. The state was this Islamic Republic of Pakistan. And then there was a lot of people sort of felt as an oppositional, and people mobilized behind this. And that is how you gain strength behind certain, there would be passion involved. So that no matter how we want, I mean, you know, I don't want to get into this, what is secular Islamism, this, that, and other. But I think the killings and the tolerance of diversity, different viewpoint, this is what also democracy is all about, or the way we. But I think it cannot be just a state project. So that the 50s and 60s generation did their battle, and then they brought it up to the 70s and all of that. So now, if the current young generation, they want to again do something about create a lot of popular support behind this, you have to have a lot more of people support. Then I think this project has to be, then that struggle has to be done by people themselves and not as sponsored project. I think one of the problems that we found that happened with the Shahbagh movement, for instance, it was a very spontaneous kind of movement that has happened. But then once then you get sort of some state parties get interested, then they get sort of, then it can be co-opted. So I think to maintain that authenticity of voice, I think for Bangladesh, if we want to then, I won't say go back, because you can never go back, really, you know, so it has to be another new formulation. This has to be, you know, done as part of a people's movement kind of a project, and not as a state project, and whether it is for religious tolerance or the tolerance of diversity or secularism, I have actually no problem, you know, my understanding of secularism was as was in 1972, and that, and I think I would not have any problem calling myself secularist in that way. My religion is my personal religion, but that would not impinge on my behavior towards anybody else. And I think that is, but I think that this is what is very much now, I think that is where we are failing, you know, in some way, that there is really not, I mean, Dina talked about some social movement, but as she herself said, that I don't know how long that will take. But I think it is very also important that you get into some scale. If you are very authentic and you have a voice, but you are very small, and you remain small for 50 years, and other forces are then gaining ground, then I think, you know, there could be, this is what I meant by, you know, these binary categories. When you are in a political struggle, it is when you look at it as a political movement, then some of these things would be used by other people also, so you cannot circle. But I would say that the danger I find now is that, you know, this, you know, it cannot be just a state project. It has to be the people's project, and that is where we are now failing.
I'll just try and answer Tinku's, you know, give a response to Tinku's outrage or disappointment of this panel. Yes, of course, secular spaces are shrinking. A lot of spaces of dissent are shrinking. I want to say, I was not saying that there isn't Islamist, there isn't a problem with extremist Islam in Bangladesh. I would say that we have to distinguish, when, especially when we're talking in the US, but I don't think it's just that, that we have to, there are different structures, different kinds of knowledge formation around Islam and Hinduism right now. So I think all we do is denounce Islam a lot, not just here, but in Bangladesh. That becomes the fallback for understanding everything. That becomes the only analytical lens through which we understand the problems inside Bangladesh. I think that's extremely inadequate. That is not to say there isn't a problem with Islam. Okay, so of course Rakesh Sharma is going to come here and talk about Hindutva, and I think it's Hinduism has a very lovely, soft image in the U.S. It's got to do with the Cold War and area studies and all of that. You know, there's a long history to that. Whereas Islam has a very different history in Europe and the United States, and that orientalizing history has also been absorbed within Bangladesh. And all I'm saying is that one needs to locate that, one needs to have one's analytical focus not be completely taken over by a certain kind of obsession with Islam as the only thing that's wrong with Bangladesh. Because if you do, you're not going to talk about inequality, you're not going to talk about indigenous rights, you're not even going to talk about, I think I totally agree with you that minorities, especially, you know, minorities do live under a lot of fear in Bangladesh, but that's why I was trying to make a distinction between the public celebration of puja that, you know, is wonderful, and the fact that there is incredible land grabbing going on right now. And it's really not about Islamism, that land grabbing. It's about a certain kind of economics that we need to talk about. Okay? And it does fall, you know, it's extremely imbricated in minority politics. But we're not going to ever understand, we're not going to understand the fear that people in the Chittagong Hill Tracts has of the army. Okay? If we just think about Islam, we might want to think about Bangladeshi nationalism and its extremely exclusionary aspects of ethno-nationalism in Bangladesh. We might want to rethink nationalism if we want a different kind of language of justice. Bangladeshi nationalism, this is being taped, I suppose, but, oh well, but I think there is something extremely narrow about it, and we've got to revisit that. Okay, so...
I think that's a conflict we have never resolved.
I think there's the originary contradiction.
Yeah, I mean, why do you have to resolve everything that, as if to the dark, we will have to resolve? All nations have unresolved issues. The race issue has never been resolved in the United States.
Unfortunately, that's what is being the narrative of the state and the power.
Right.
That is why it is important.
So let's engage with that debate. My point is that to try to resolve everything, that we can resolve issues in 2012 or 2015 or 2032. Why do you want to resolve? We might not be able to resolve those things. But as much as much close can we come to the resolution is fine, but most importantly accepting that there are some unresolved issues that we need to address as a nation. I think that is more important than just trying to resolve it either through sheer force from the street or through the machetes or the other weapons or using the state project. That seems to be problematic to me personally.
So I wanted, not only as we do, and in this case in particular, to thank these three scholars for coming,
thank you.
But thank you all for